Hello, and welcome to Grandma's Garden. This is still the beginning of September. I think we're going to open each show to try to tell you what season of the year we're in. Maybe some of the pictures in our bird pictures may be a different season, but we'll get there. I'm Evelyn, and my co-host is Kathy. We are sitting in Kathy's garden, so that you know where we're at. And we're going to talk to you about publications, ways to find your seeds, to learn more about what to do for your garden. I think we should start with the Michigan Gardener. Now I'm trying to get where that reflection, there we go. Now I've got it so you can see it. This is published every month, and you can find this in all of your nurseries.
Library sometimes has it. Sometimes other shops have it.
It has so much information in it. Things that you want to learn. Clematis plants are wilting. Why? Okay, well, they tell. Caring for Japanese pyrees. Books, weather wrap.
This was a nice article about grasses.
Yes.
One of the things that I like about it is that it gives you, that there's a lot of advertising in it by nurseries and garden stores.
That's okay.
But absolutely fabulous. I found a place up on Rochester Road that is actually fairly new, and it's called Picnics. It looks like Pie Chink in the ad, but I called them up and they said it's pronounced Picnics. They've taken over a place that went out of business several years ago. They had a wonderful, wonderful garden store. Great place to check out if you are looking for gifts for the gardener.
And we have another magazine. This is one of Kathy's. I've not seen this one.
Talk about the couple that you get or got. The Garden Gate.
Garden Gate. To me, it's the Bible of the garden magazines. Or to me, it's the best of the garden magazines. It also costs me a lot of money because I always want what they've got on that pictured. And I'm searching. Sometimes they'll have brand new plants that are just coming on the market and you can't find them. But anyway, it gives me ideas of what to do in my garden. What do I want to do different this year? And in December, January, February, March, it gives me color. It makes me feel better. Kathy.
there are quite a few different garden magazines. Now this is kind of one that is for the hobby farmer, back to the land kind of people. Lots of tips on canning. They also include some things about chickens and goats and stuff that Evelyn in her condo couldn't possibly do, and my neighbors might might draw the line. My neighbors are very tolerant. They let me grow asparagus in the front yard.
But that's pretty and tall and ferny and lovely.
For veggies, primary thing for veggies can be organic gardening. This is really, I've been getting this magazine off and on since I first started planting vegetables. Lots of good tips, lots of good information. And then the other thing we wanted to talk to you about is, even though it's only September, Christmas is coming. I have found the very best solution to not...
love this idea. This is getting so good sometimes.
Not getting things from my kids for Christmas. You know, if Evelyn and I are at the point where we've got enough stuff that sits on the shelf. You know, please don't give me anything that sits on the shelf unless I specifically ask for it.
Yeah.
So I will take my favorite catalog, and the sale catalogs are coming now. I like Gardener's Supply. I like Plow and Hearth. Sometimes I will even take my favorite seed catalog. And get a little pack of Post-it notes, and you
so
find the thing that you want. I'm not quite sure where in here the Morning Glory solar lights are. But I will put some Post-it notes in here. Pack these catalogs up, put them in a brown envelope, and mail them to my daughter-in-law, and I can be guaranteed that one or more of these items will be under the Christmas tree. And the nice thing about that particular Christmas gift is it's a gift you get twice.
Yes.
I'm all excited about it when I open it up at Christmas. Oh, yes, she did get the morning glory lights. Then comes spring, and it's time to put,
we'll put it up.
Here's the morning glory lights.
Yes.
And if you have a gardener in your family, do think about asking them what they'd like for the garden, because it's definitely the gift that gives twice. And when I go around my garden, I think of my children, because I have a little table, bistro table and chairs that you can see under the umbrella there. That was a Mother's Day gift from my kids.
Pretty cool.
I have a fountain that was a gift from all my kids one year for Mother's Day. I have some gazing balls. I have fairy statues.
And you see that purple chair? Do you see the purple chair right there? That came from me, but it was white.
We will have a show when we talk about winter interests.
Yes.
Fun to leave some things in there that show up in the snow.
Yeah.
Actually, the chair was white. Then it was blue at your house.
Then it was blue at my house.
When I got it, it was blue, and I went to the hardware store and got the purple paint and painted the purple chairs. But this is a great fun thing. And a nice way to be sure that what you get for Christmas is something you would really, really like. Or if you have a gardener in your family, you can always say, hey, why don't you mark a few things in your favorite catalog and send them to me for a Christmas list.
Yes, I like that idea very, very much.
And then we've talked to you a couple times about walking around and seeing what worked, and keeping track of what was going on in your garden.
Mm-hmm.
There's all kinds of ways to do this. Now, Ev's got the quick and easy, cheapest way.
This is my little book. You're not seeing it too well because it's green.
There's not much to see.
But that being said, it is nothing more than just a little notebook. And in it, I plant so many things. The easiest way to do it is to scotch tape a picture to one side and then write down the information on the other side. For this Gallardia, I have put down, it's particularly called Arizona Sun, and so that I can understand, I guess, I don't know if you can see that or not, but I have a little sun in there to show me whether it's sun or part shade. Then I'll say what color it is, I'll say when it blooms. And then this one happens to be deer resistant. That's important information because people are always asking for deer resistant plants. When to cut it, what else to do with it. In my book, there is a lot of pictures. When I get I got the foxglove. Usually on the little tag that comes in the plant is all the information that you need. So I will scotch tape that on one page, and then I will put on here where I planted it. I have the unfortunate, I move things around, and next summer I can't find it because I don't remember where I put it. So I try to write down in here that the plant originally went in one garden, and for some unknown reason I decided it needed to live somewhere else. So I try to keep track in here. I keep track of my mistakes. I made a blatantly stupid mistake this year. It's recorded. I don't have to share it with you. You don't have to know everything. But I also put in here what didn't come back. For some reason, I cannot, There's one plant that I just can't get it to come back. I had them and delphinium. I had delphinium and then I didn't have delphinium. And then I bought some more delphinium and put them in another part of the garden. And the next year I didn't have delphinium. And I have no idea.
They don't like your soil. I have probably spent
Do they need sugar or salt and pepper? What do they want?
I don't know. They probably want salsa when you plant them. I have spent hundreds of dollars trying to cultivate delphinium. My mother used to have the most beautiful delphinium you ever want to see. They don't like my soil. I've given up on delphinium.
But now, they grow for us.
Well,
that's the garden right next to mine.
Probably smell all the smoke coming out of his window.
Oh,
and anyway, there are all kinds of garden books. These are ones that happen to be gifts that I got. I like this one very much.
If we can turn it this way, can you see it? Yeah, there you can.
Okay.
Okay.
It's basically a little diary type of thing, but it doesn't have dates. Like Ev, I put notes in here, pictures. I grow a lot of different kinds of cherry tomatoes. I copied the descriptions out of the seed catalog so I would know what worked and what didn't. I make notes in there. This is from March of 2012. It says, warmest March in history. Many record-breaking days have seen things this month that usually happen late April or May. March 26th, the magnolia and forsythia are in bloom. These are things that normally bloom in May. So it's kind of nice, and I can go back from time to time. Now this year, this was a gift, and it was a gift that I post-it noted in a catalog. It's a 5-year garden journal, but it's awfully structured for me. It wants things like temperature and, what else?
Color in the garden, special pleasures, lessons learned.
I like to just sit at that little table under the umbrella and have a glass of wine and write down what's on my mind about what happened well in the garden.
This would be a good spot to say our email address is grandmasgarden@ontv. If there's something that worked and you want to share it with us, please. And if there's something that didn't work and you're willing to share it, I'll share mine eventually, but let us know. But you can get in contact with us. You can also send us pictures. You can email us pictures. We used one of the pictures in the show that we did the other day of the hibiscus, Rose of Sharon, that was sent to us. So we'd love to share your garden. Go ahead, Kathy.
Well, now we're going to move on to a topic near and dear to me.
Whoops, that's me.
Ev's going to kind of be my helper on this one because living in a condo, she's not really able to have bird feeders. Birds add so much to your garden. They eat so many bugs, just do all sorts of things. And if we could have the first picture, please.
Okay, we've got 2 minutes to wind up.
Oh.
Okay, so go ahead and talk about what the birds do, and then we'll get to the bird feeders.
Oh, okay. Birds just add so much to your garden. They eat the bugs.
Well, she's got a couple of cats, and they sit in the window, and it just are thoroughly entertained by watching the birds. She also has a friend, Evelyn, who can't have birds, that comes over and sits in the window with the cats and watches the birds and will go, what's that? Oh, I've never seen that before. She, just like that, she can tell me what it is, what it does, where it comes from, when it comes in the spring, fall.
Well, I've been living in my house for 24 years. And so, you know, you kind of get used to what is there. I'm one of those people that maybe a little bit obsessive. If I see it, I need to know what it is. It doesn't make any difference whether it's a tree or a plant or a bird.
Right.
My son hates to see me coming because we go out driving in the country and I say, what kind of tree is that, Kevin? He says, Mother, I don't know.
You know.
But so anyhow, I have a bird book. My favorite bird book is the National Audubon Society Field Guide. I do have several other ones, but it's really good for helping you figure out which birds are which.
She also has a bird book with the chirping sounds. And a lot of times she can tell me what bird it is just by hearing it. It just boggles my mind.
That book was a gift from my daughter. And
that's a lovely
book. It's a lovely, lovely book because sometimes I will be out in the garden and I hear a sound I haven't heard before.
Yeah.
And I can go in and I know pretty much whether it's going to be a waterfowl or a little bird or a big bird. And I can go through and play those
sounds. Yes, you've done that. Yes.
And it's really, really a fun book.
Again, we're going to wind up this segment of our show and give you our email address again. If you have questions, if you have a question about birds, don't ask me because I'm not going to know anything, although I appreciate them. We are at email us at grandmasgarden at ontv.org. And I'm Evelyn, and my co-host is Kathy. And we will be back in a few minutes.
We own a habitat home.
I love working on my habitat home.
Soy dueño de una casa de habitat.
My neighbor is a habitat homeowner.
Being a habitat homeowner has changed our lives.
My mortgage payment for Habitat is less than what I paid for rent.
Habitat for Humanity of Oakland County currently has homes available with mortgage payments lower than most rent payments. If you or someone you know needs decent and affordable housing, call 248-338-1843 or visit our website at habitatoakland.org.
Hello, and welcome back to Grandma's Garden. I'm Evelyn, and our co-host is Kathy. Kathy is going to talk to you about birds, and she's got some beautiful pictures of birds to share with you, share with all of us. And I am going to be the prop manager, and I'm just going to let Kathy go ahead and tell you about her birds.
And if we could have the first picture, please.
There.
To start out with, while we're still in September here, most gardeners who have flowers have hummingbirds. And even Evelyn probably could hide a hummingbird feeder somewhere.
She might try.
And you may think you don't see them because they're there such a short period of time.
I have seen hummingbirds by my garden.
This little guy, I think, just wanted to be on the show because this feeder happens to hang outside my kitchen window. I saw him and I thought, oh, I wonder if he'll stay long enough so I can get the camera. I went and got the camera. He let me take 4 shots.
Wow.
So he probably was there at least a minute and a half. But the reason I'm particularly wanting to show these little guys fly all the way to Mexico.
Right.
And they will not be leaving until sometime in October, depending on when the weather turns cold.
Mm-hmm.
So if you've been feeding the hummingbirds, please don't stop. Don't say, oh, it's September, they're gone, I'm sure.
Mm.
They're not gone. I have 2. I have that feeder that George just showed you the picture of. I also have one outside of my living room window. And those little guys are there almost nonstop now.
I watched a special, and it's called They're Tanking Up for Their Flying South. They're really getting as many calories into themselves as possible before they head south.
And with the hummingbird feeders, you want to always wash the feeder out.
Yes, once a week.
But every time you refill it, you want to wash it out. And when you store it away at the end of the season, you want to wash it out and then rinse it out with some water with a few drops of laundry bleach.
Oh, really? Okay.
This will disinfect it. You want to let it thoroughly dry before you put it away. But it's time to start filling the feeders. And if we could have the next picture.
There we go.
Oh, okay.
Sorry about that.
This is a red-bellied woodpecker. And if you maybe can get me the suet. Yeah. They like suet. These guys are around year-round. We have 3 or 4 woodpeckers in the area. There's this red-bellied downy, which is a little bitty guy that's black and white.
He's got a red head.
Yeah,
is he still a red belly?
Yeah, he doesn't have much of a red belly. He's kind of a misnamer.
Okay.
And then there are the flickers, which are even bigger than this guy.
Okay.
And
okay.
This is a suet feeder. This is probably one of the cheapest feeders you can buy. Little wire box, you can get these cakes, and you put the cake in the box, hang it up, and there you go. That's all there is to it. They do have some seed in them. I want to talk a little bit about thinking about where you're going to put your bird feeders. If you hang them in your garden, you need to be prepared that the seeds that drop from the feeder will sprout, and you will have grassy or weed things.
Yeah.
You can prevent this by sprinkling preen, which is the weed inhibitor, in the area underneath your feeder, and then the seeds won't germinate. I mostly put my feeders out over the lawn.
Right.
Because then whatever lawn treatment gets done, or they get mowed off, so...
it's not a problem.
It's not a problem. You also want to locate your feeders away from cover.
Cover, what do you mean cover?
What kind of cover? Someplace where the cats can hide.
Oh, bushes.
Bushes, shrubs. Okay. It needs to be out in the open so that predators, and we will show you another predator that may come visit your feeder.
Okay.
This is one of my favorite. This is a new feeder. This is not my newest feeder, but it's one of my new feeders. Picked this up at a craft show, and basically it's two wide-mouth mason jars and a nicely sort of sanded down board. You put the seed in there. The little guys can hop in, and they were kind of reluctant at first.
Because it's enclosed?
Because it's enclosed.
Stick their head in.
They just weren't quite sure they wanted to do that. But now they're in there all the time. And this is a red-winged blackbird.
Right.
The birds can be an indicator of the season.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I have springs here. When I hear the red wings, I know springs here. I also, when I see the starlings in the spring, I know springs here. Starlings are not exactly my favorite bird. They eat up an awful lot of stuff. They make a lot of noise, which is why the suet feeder that you saw with inside the cage, the starlings are a bigger bird. They can't get inside there to get to the suet.
Really?
So this, anybody can get at this, including Mr. Squirrel. So I like the kind of feeders. There are also seed feeders that you can get that are inside a cage.
Okay.
And the bigger, but then you don't get some of the nicer birds.
Some of the littler birds.
You get only little birds there.
Can you show the other picture of the squirrel feeder? Can you show the next picture, George? The squirrel in the feeder? Well, it's going to come eventually. There we go.
Okay.
There we go. Look at that.
Okay.
Isn't that cute?
If you feed the birds, you will have squirrels.
Yeah.
There's just, I don't think there's any place in North America that doesn't have squirrels. Those are called gray squirrels. They're actually more brown.
Right.
We have had black squirrels move into our area recently. And I saw something that almost looks like a hybrid between the red little flying squirrel and a gray squirrel.
It's really?
The little red squirrels can be very destructive if they get in your attic or get in your eaves, but they're awful cute. They're not much bigger than a chipmunk, and they have a white tummy. Now, I saw one of the gray squirrels with a white tummy, and he was a little smaller, so I don't know if we had a little squirrel hybridization going on at my house or not quite.
I'm just going to throw in here. I'm not sure if I'm going to bust anybody's bubble here, but I still consider them all vermin. Go ahead.
They kind of are. This is talk about.
Look at it closely to see what it is.
It's a simple. We call this the Christmas feeder, and we put this up every year on the 24th of December. It's a homemade, jerry-rigged 2-liter pop bottle. I cut the top off of it. It's a wire hanger that is cut, and you attach it and hook it and fill it up with nuts in the shell. It takes them maybe a half a day. Of course, at my house, they know this is going to be there.
Right.
It's coming. So they recognize it. The first time I put it up, I think somebody gave me a whole big bag of nuts in the shell, and I didn't quite know what to do with them.
Right.
But it gets funnier as the time goes on, because as the nuts get
deeper in the jar,
the squirrel's got to go farther down there. And if it's a kind of a warm early winter,
get wet.
Well, they get wet, but also you have the blue jays like nuts.
We have blue jays in the wintertime?
Sometimes we do, sometimes we don't. Sometimes they take off, and sometimes they're still around.
See how much I don't know about birds. Anyway.
But the squirrel has to keep getting farther and farther down there, but it's pretty funny when you get the blue jay in the bottom of the 2-liter pop bottle.
Oh, get a picture of that one. There's your Cooper's hawk.
Oh, okay, and another something you're going to get. This is a Cooper's hawk. They are
it's beautiful.
Widely seen in Michigan, particularly in this North Oakland County area.
Hate
to say it, but it's part of the natural cycle. They dine on the guests at your feeder.
The little birds will
come in and grab off a little bird, but they are so beautiful. You may occasionally see a red-tailed hawk, which is about twice the size of that guy. That guy is a little bit bigger than a big crow.
Oh, okay, okay.
You see them year-round, but you're more apt to see them in the wintertime, of course, because the trees are bare.
Okay. I was at Kathy's house when the Cooper's hawk came in, and it kept darting down to the shrub. Now, her feeder is a ways away from the shrub, but it kept darting down to the shrub, and Kathy informed me of what was going on. Nature was taking its course because he finally dove into that shrub and got that little wren, and off he went with it. And I'm going, what? Okay, I guess. All right.
Well, you kind of get used to the life cycle.
Right.
And if you could show us the other picture of the tree with all the feeders in it and the orioles.
Well,
I'm very fortunate to have this lovely magnolia tree.
I don't think
tree.
I have that. I don't think I put that picture in. I'm sorry.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry. My fault.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm very fortunate that I have a magnolia tree outside my living room window, and it's full of different feeders. I change the feeders out at the time of year, depending on what birds are there and what birds are not. Now, one I'm not looking forward to seeing who's going to show up one of these days is the slate-colored junco. It's a little gray bird with a white tummy. And when you see him, you know the snow is not far behind.
Oh, okay.
So I'll let you know when the juncos are here.
Okay, all right.
But on the other hand, when they're gone, you can know that spring's right around the corner.
Oh, that's good. All right.
Now, there's all different kinds of feeders. They range from $2 little plastic thing that I probably would not recommend because they don't hold enough seed and the squirrels are going to chew a hole in them. Got to use this show as an occasion for picking up a couple of new feeders. This is one that the chickadees are surely going to like. The top, the top opens up. I'm not quite sure how, but I'm sure it does. And you fill it up with sunflower seeds or sunflower and safflower seeds, and the little birds just sort of all cling around to the outside. Woodpeckers kind of like that one as well. Now, you won't get any cardinals or blue jays or grosbeaks or any of those kind of birds. Another one of my favorites, I was not able to find, that's probably enough with
okay.
that one, that is a thistle seed feeder. That's the yellow one.
Okay.
And now this is just all wire mesh. And you probably could put something other than thistle seed in here.
It's awfully tiny holes, awfully tiny.
Okay. There are certain birds that like thistle seed. Now, thistle seed's kind of expensive, so I don't put this out until maybe late February.
Okay.
The thistle seed costs $4 or $5 a pound.
Oh,
kind
okay.
of in the range with good chocolate, you know.
All right, now chocolate I can talk
well,
about.
But the goldfinches are so beautiful.
Yeah,
they're and it's kind of you watch spring develop, and you can see they start getting yellow and they get yellower and yellower.
Oh,
and
okay.
So I put the thistle seed out to watch that, and we got to show them the pasta resistance.
Oh yes, yes. I'm sure this cost more than $2.
This was out of my price range, but it's the queen. My daughter treated me to this feeder, and thank you, Vicki. It has three different tubes for three different types of seed. It has a baffle, which keeps the squirrel from helping himself. It's got a tray. Your birds like cardinals, like some sort of a ridge thing that they can sit on. So we're going to be able to put some, and you can change the side of the feeding capacity, so you can put thistle seed and sunflower seed and regular bird seed in here.
Oh, this turns.
Yeah.
Oh.
Turns around so you can do different sizes.
Oh, very clever.
So I hope that you got a little bit of information and you'll think about feeding the birds.
You can leave it there.
And,
well, this has been very educational for me. Don't know much about birds. I do appreciate them. I do get to see them when I go over to Kathy's house and sit with the cats and watch the birds. Again, if you want to get in contact with us, don't ask me, but if you want to ask Kathy about birds, we are at Grandma's Garden at ONTV.org. Send us your emails, send us your questions. If you have a picture of a bird and you want to know what it is, maybe Kathy probably will know. And we will see you again next time. This is Kathy and Evelyn saying goodbye. We'll see you on our next show.